great, that's a great reception. Thank you especially to all my little group of colleagues down here at the front. We're all astronomers at a place called Jodrell Bank.
Yay.
So yes, thank you, Jodrell Bankers. Yeah, I haven't got the heart to tell them it's rhyming slang. So what I do at Jodrell Bank is study something called pulsars, which are left over after massive stars explode in a supernova. And if you're talking dimensions, pulsars are very, very small. They're about 20 kilometers across, they're as heavy as the sun, they can spin up to 700 times a second, and they shoot beams of radio waves out of their magnetic poles. And so when we see them, they're something like a sort of a radio lighthouse. And so we pick them up with telescopes like this one at Jodrell Bank. That's except for on Sundays when we use it to watch Sky Sports. Now, pulsars are kind of ridiculous objects. Everything about them is a bit ridiculous, and the most ridiculous thing is how dense they are. So, density is mass divided by volume. And in the case of a pulsar, we're talking about the mass of the sun crammed into the volume of about an asteroid. Or to put it in more sensible units, it's 500 million Tyrannosaurus rexes per teaspoon. So if there's one thing I want you to take away from this talk, is that pulsars are made from compressed dinosaurs. Now, possibly because pulsars sound quite futuristic, companies like to name things after them. So this is what I think a pulsar looks like. It can go up to 40,000 revolutions per minute. But in the 1980s, Nissan decided that this was a pulsar. Clearly the car of the future, as you can see. But at 6,000 RPM, it doesn't quite match up to the real thing. However, there is now a real rival, and that is the pulsar 2000. Okay, 40,000 vibrations per minute. I spent years studying pulsars, and Oral-B is named a toothbrush after them. But I do own this toothbrush. Yeah, I saw it in boots, so I couldn't help it. So there is one more thing that's also called a pulsar, and that's a wristwatch. And this is kind of getting a bit closer to the real thing, because the pulses we get from pulsars are very much like the sort of the ticks of a clock. Only the wristwatch is accurate to about 1 second in every 10 days or something. The real pulsar can be accurate to 1 second in a million years. So we've got all these amazing clocks throughout space, and what we use them for is to try and detect something called gravitational waves. Okay, now I'm not going to try and explain what a gravitational wave is. Instead, I'm just going to try and do an impression of a gravitational wave going through my face. Okay? And just to make me feel a bit less stupid, I'd like people to join in. So what you need to do is begin by stretching your face out like this, and then squash it together, and then just repeat. Squash it. Great, this is why I need to do this. Step down, squash it. Okay, and that, well, it's a room full of people gurning, really. But it's also what it would look like if a massive gravitational wave passed straight through your face. Okay? It's like a face-stretching, space-stretching ripple in the cosmos. And this is one I prepared earlier. That's Albert Einstein. It's his theory of relativity that predicts all this stuff. And I just like it because his grin gets so big. Now, you probably never really felt like you were being stretched by a gravitational wave like this. And that's because the effects of real gravitational waves are so tiny that no one has ever actually detected one. But we think we can do it with pulsars because as they stretch and squash space as gravitational waves, they change how long those pulsar ticks take to get to us. Okay. Oh, skipping ahead of myself. Change how long it takes to get to us. Now, we think we can do it, but the thing is that the detection of gravitational waves is set to be the official one, about 5 years away. Thing was, when I started my PhD in 2006, it was also 5 years away. So we had to try and baffle people with science by telling them there's relativity and, you know, 5 years for you and 5 years for me. Isn't the same? But the truth is, we're still looking so the project I'm involved with is actually using five big radio telescopes all across Europe, just like one giant telescope, to just to try and improve the accuracy that we can measure these pulsar ticks with. And to try and illustrate my own sort of contribution to this project, I want you to imagine the film Contact. Have you seen that?
Yeah.
Woo! Okay. I want you to imagine, of course, that I am Jodie Foster. Okay. I've never said that before on a weekday. So, I've got my dishes, and I've got my headphones, and I'm listening to the signals from space, even though that's not what radio astronomers really do. And I hear a sound. Is it aliens? No. The sound is this. Because someone has left their bloody mobile phone on and screwing up the signal. And so what I actually do in this project is to... Someone else left their amazing time. Is I clean interference out of our data. And these signals, you can imagine, they take thousands of years to get here. And there's a whole army of mobile phones and radar and fly zappers just ready to screw them up in the last microsecond of their journey. So that's what I do. And sometimes I get asked the question that all astronomers get asked at some stage, which is, what is the practical benefit of what you do? To which I never reply, piss off. It's too cool not to do. That's why I do it. No, I don't say that. Because with pulsars, we kind of have an answer. Pulsars can actually make really good sort of navigation beacons for deep space travel. So sort of like interstellar GPS. And so we just say, oh, yeah, using for interstellar GPS. All that has to happen is someone has to invent an interstellar spaceship that can fly around the stars. But you know, Richard Branson's working on that. It's probably about 5 years away. But anyway, it could happen, and it got me thinking, if pulsars were used to GPS, would they also double as service stations in space? Now, it would take, admittedly, hundreds of years to travel between them, but I mean, that's no worse than the M6, isn't it? I think they compare quite well to service stations. I mean, again, if you went too close to a pulsar, you would be vaporized by X-rays. But on the other hand, compare that to, you know, your average service station toilet lights and how harsh they are. Probably fairly similar. And again, if you get too close to a pulsar to try and land on it, the gravitational pull at your feet will be so much stronger than your head that you'll be stretched out in a process that is actually genuinely called spaghettification. But again, spaghettification or service station spaghetti. Which is really worse? I mean, which is more likely to kill you? So, pulsars are useful, kind of. But as for me, I think I'm just going to stick to using them to try and keep Einstein grinning. There he is again. Thank you very much.